Like to welcome you to the AV 1611 Hour. My name is Nelson Turner, and this broadcast is dedicated to the King James Bible, the Word of God in the English language for the end time English-speaking peoples of the earth. And I'd like to thank you for taking the time to hear my speech or to watch the video. Now, I want to go to the infallible, inerrant, inspired Word of God in the English language, the Cambridge 1769 King James Bible, in Numbers chapter 20. And the topic of this sermon is Speak to the Rock. Christ is indeed our rock, and we are to speak to Him. We are to pray to Him. We pray to the Father through the Lord Jesus Christ. He is at the right hand of God the Father, and He ever lives to intercede for us. We are to worship the Lord Jesus Christ. There's never any place in the New Testament where you find a man or a woman who throws himself on their face before the Lord Jesus Christ while He was in His ministry on the earth, found in fashion as a man. You never find a single place where He refused worship from worshipers that were drawn to Him. And so we must worship the Lord in spirit and in truth, and we worship God the Father through the Son by the grace of the Spirit. This is the example of the way to worship God in spirit and truth according to John chapter 4, laid out in the New Testament, laid out in fact in the Old Testament, and laid out in the New Testament church down to the present time. There is a New Testament church, the invisible but visible body of Christ, the church militant here upon the earth, those that are joined to Jesus Christ in an everlasting love union, predicated upon the will of God and the love of God for His own, and those that are joined to Jesus Christ worship Him in spirit and truth by His Spirit in His Word of truth, which they are sanctified by. Sanctify them through thy truth, thy word is truth. John 17:17, the King James Bible. And I mean the Cambridge 1769 edition. I don't mean the literal 1769, but those texts that follow it. These are the final result, all these different books that are called the Cambridge edition following the 1769 printing. These are the final format of the Word of God in the English language for the end time English-speaking peoples of the world. The refining process, the tumbling down through time and translation and language of God's Word in the English ceased at the King James. There has been no update. There has been no further unction given by God and put upon any translation since the King James English. Are you, as much as you would like, the King's English is the word of a king, and where the word of a king is, there is power. Who may say unto him, what doest thou? Ecclesiastes 8:4. It is the word of a king. It is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. Hebrews 4:12. And so we do well to take heed to this light that we find in the word of God, which presents the light of the world, the Lord Jesus Christ. Now in Numbers chapter 20, we have the story told, the history given of an incident in the wilderness of Zin, in the desert. Right now, Christians live in a desert of sin, in a body of flesh in this world, though they are joined to the Lord and are one spirit. Then came the children of Israel. This is chapter 20, Numbers, verse 1. My text will be taken from verse 9, 10, 11, 12, and 13, and I will read down through there. Then came the children of Israel, even the whole congregation, into the desert of Zin in the first month. And the people abode in Kadesh, and Miriam died there and was buried there. And there was no water for the congregation. And they gathered themselves together against Moses and against Aaron. And the people chode with Moses and spake, saying, would God that we had died when our brethren died before the Lord. They're speaking of an incident previously recorded in Numbers, the company of Korah and Dathan and Abiram. And why have ye brought up the congregation of the Lord into this wilderness, that we and our cattle should die there? And wherefore have ye made us to come up out of Egypt, to bring us into this evil place? It is no place of seed, or of figs, or of vines, or of pomegranates. Neither is there any water to drink. And Moses and Aaron went from the presence of the assembly unto the door of the tabernacle of the congregation, and they fell upon their faces. And the glory of the Lord appeared unto them. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, Take the rod, and gather thou the assembly together, thou and Aaron thy brother, and speak ye unto the rock before their eyes. And it shall give forth his water, and thou shalt bring forth to them water out of the rock. So thou shalt give the congregation and their beasts drink. And Moses took the rod from before the Lord, as he commanded him. And Moses and Aaron gathered the congregation together before the rock. And he said unto them, Hear now, ye rebels, must we fetch you water out of this rock? And Moses lifted up his hand, and with his rod he smote the rock twice. And the water came out abundantly, and the congregation drank, and their beasts also. And the Lord spake unto Moses and Aaron, Because ye believed me not to sanctify me in the eyes of the children of Israel, therefore ye shall not bring this congregation into the land which I have given them. This is the water of Meribah. Because the children of Israel strove with the Lord, and he was sanctified in them. Heavenly Father, I thank thee now for this time to preach forth thy word. I have no power to do it, except by thy grace and thy spirit. And I cannot speak or say anything right, good, true, or wholesome, except it be in conformity to the word of God, and except it be directed by the Spirit of God, which thou hast vouchsafed unto all thy people through all time and place, as an earnest of the redemption that's yet to come of the body. We thank thee now for this time, and we thank thee for the fellowship of the saints, both here now and yet to come. In Jesus Christ's name and for his glory and honor, we pray, amen. Now, we can go back and briefly rehearse the circumstances of what occurs. Moses was commanded in verse 8 to speak to the rock, hence the title of the sermon. He's to speak unto the rock before their eyes. They were in a state of rebellion. They were in a state of unbelief concerning God's provision for them in the wilderness of this world. Many of you have experienced that. Even you brothers and sisters in Christ have experienced at times an utter failing to believe that things are going to work out, that God will provide for you. And what happens to unregenerate people, and we know from the account in Numbers and the recitation in Deuteronomy and the events, even in Joshua, that many people in the Israelite congregation during various generations were in complete unbelief, even though they saw signs and wonders performed by God through God's man and directly from heaven by God, they doubted the Lord. They did not trust and believe in him. They would not trust him to deliver them out of a temporal conflict, out of an earthly need. They did not trust him to feed them. They did not trust him to clothe them. They did not trust him. They did not believe in him, though their leader, their minister, their preacher believed in the Lord, and the Lord counted it unto him for righteousness. Just like Abraham, Moses was justified by faith and not by the deeds of the law and the works of the law. He was justified by faith. And we see in this account that he indeed lost reward, so to speak, here in this world for disobedience here in this world. But we want to look at the circumstances and the situation concerning the man of God, Moses, and his brother, the priest, Aaron, and the sister, Miriam, and what then transpired. Miriam died and was buried there. Remember, it was Miriam that had drawn Moses up out of the ark of bulrushes from the river Nile. It was Miriam, actually, I shouldn't say it was Miriam that did it. It was Pharaoh's daughter. But you see, Miriam was the one that watched Moses float in the ark of bulrushes. And then when the Egyptian woman was looking for someone to nurse the little suckling babe, Miriam was right there to carry the babe off to his mother so that he could be nursed by his natural mother. The very providential arrangement of God that Moses would be raised essentially in the house of Pharaoh, and that his own mother would be able to nurse him, which is the most helpful thing. His own natural mother would be able to nurse him and care for him till he came of an age to be weaned. And then he's taken into Pharaoh's household, and he becomes learned in all the arts of the Egyptians. And yet, he sees, and this is the great error of the proponents of the mystery religions. This is the great error of many, many, many purported conspiracy researchers. They research and read so much about the mystery religion, the workers of iniquity, their plans, their secret societies, their cabals, and all the rest. In case you don't know, I will say this, I've said it previously, the word C-A-B-A-L, cabal, or cabal, however people pronounce it, stands for Clifford, Arlington, Buckingham, Ashley, and Lauderdale, ministers of the Star Chamber during the time of Charles I and James. These people were alive in the times of James I and Charles I, and they were a secret group of men operating with the monarch's approval and involved in iniquitous decisions against the people of the nation of England, for whom they were supposed to be ministers to. Anyway, this situation that occurred in Numbers chapter 20 is very plain. Miriam dies. Now, if your sister dies, and she basically was involved in the saving of your life when you were very young, you grew up with her, you loved her dearly, and she was your older sister, would you not be grieved at her death? So in a moment, when by nature, and even in the spirit, because you remember Miriam danced with the women at the deliverance of Israel from the Egyptian army, she danced with the timbrel, and Miriam died. Moses and Aaron are grieved. And right at this very moment, the devil moves upon the congregation to be stirred up because they see no provision of water for themselves. Now the Lord has promised to take care of them. He's promised to care for their souls, but they cannot see where the provision will come on. They are in a desert and there is no water. And so the devil stirs up the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life in these people. And they gather themselves together against Moses and against Aaron. Right when Moses and Aaron are in a state of grief for the death of their sister. And the people chode with Moses and said, "Would God that we had died when our brother died before the Lord." Probably every one of you, either in your heart or with your mouth, has said you wished you were dead. That is the same thing that Job said, and many other. Elijah requested for himself that he might die when he sat under the tree. There are many examples in the Bible of individuals, men of God, wishing they were dead. And if you haven't experienced that, I can't make you experience that. But when you are sore pressed and vexed in your soul, and your mind and heart sink into the depths of your own depravity, as a Christian, you know what's right, but you find within yourself not the ability to even think right, and then things become hopeless. This is what happens with natural man. And recently there was an individual that blew himself and his two children in a house up with gas. When man descends into a state of hopelessness and sees no way out for himself, whether he be a malefactor and an evildoer or not, he desires that he might die. So they desire that they might die. And then they say, "Why have ye?" This is really shows you the insanity of natural men, people that are unregenerate. What do you mean regenerate in the Old Testament? I've proved conclusively and preached it, and it's available on this website, that Abraham saw the day of Christ and was glad of it. That Isaac was born of the Spirit according to the New Testament. that Jacob spoke of an angel that redeemed him. 1, 2, 3. In the mouth of 2 or 3 witnesses, let every word be established. And Job said the Spirit of God was in his nostrils. The inspiration of the Almighty giveth men understanding. Therefore, in the Old Testament, men had the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost, dwelling in them permanently. There are many, many, many heretics out there. There are many heretics. One heretic sought to teach me, or sought to beguile me and tell me through emails that the Holy Ghost and the Holy Spirit were different from one another. And then sought to teach me doctrine. And he simply used a Bible program to open up and then lay out, let's study, Pastor, and then instruct me. He didn't ask me why I believed what I believed. He was trying to put something over on me. Somebody recently sent an email, and I will not respond to the email. But where did Cain get his wife? Were Adam and Eve the first people created? Is that what the Bible teaches? Those kind of questions indicate infidelity and unbelief. Concern yourself with what you can know absolutely from the Scripture, not with peripheral things that you cannot be absolutely certain of. Assumptions can be made concerning the source or who Cain's wife was, where she came from. But my best guess is just that. I don't have the plain word of God telling me, so I concern myself not with that. But I have the plain word of God telling me that the Lord Jesus Christ has come into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. I have the plain word of God telling me here that these people said, would to God that we had died with our brethren. And then in the very next verse, look at the insanity of heretics and apostates. And why have ye brought up the congregation of the Lord into the wilderness, that we and our cattle should die there? First they said they wished they were dead, then they're complaining because they might die. That's the state of the natural man. Absolute insanity. It's not like the Christian with a new man, that's my right hand, and an old man, that's my left hand. You have an old man, you have a sinful old nature, you have a body of sin that must be destroyed, and it is in your body that is in your flesh dwelleth no good thing, but you're a new creature, created after God, in Christ, in true holiness. But these people are in a state of nature, and they're completely insane. They do not. They're double-minded and unstable in all their ways. First, they say they wish they were dead. Then they express that they are afraid they're going to die. And they say, why did you bring us up here in the wilderness to die? These are the same people that saw the Red Sea close over Pharaoh and his army. They went over the Red Sea dry shod, and the sea closed over the pursuing army. These are the same people that saw manna rain down out of heaven. These are the same people that saw fire come down out of heaven and consume 250 men standing against Moses and Aaron and waving their censers. These are the same men that saw the earth open up and swallow up a company of rebels against Moses and Aaron. These are the same people that saw Moses throw down his rod and it became a serpent, and then grab it by the tail and it becomes again a rod. And it's actually Aaron's rod that budded in the New Testament. That's how it's spoken of. So you see, look at verse 3 and verse 4. Do you ever think about the insanity of the natural man? First, they wished they had died. Then they expressed that, why did you bring us out here to die? If they really wanted to die, then they shouldn't have wanted any water. Yeah, that's just it. That's the message. Speak to the rock, and water will flow out of the rock. Speak to the rock. Speak to Christ. You see, they say they wish they were dead. Then they say, why did you bring us out here where there is no water, that we're going to die? The rebels in the Bible never find the water of life, which flows freely from God's throne. Those that are stiff-necked, stiff-necked, and hard of heart, dead in trespasses and sins, not beloved of God aforetime, not chosen in Christ from the foundation of the world, they never ever frame their doings to seek after God. They cannot do good because they are accustomed to do evil when that's all they can do. They live by what they can see, by what they can feel, what they see in their bank account, and they have no account in heaven. Wherefore have ye made us to come up out of Egypt to bring us into this evil place? They call the place that God brought them to an evil place. I call the place that God has brought me to a good place. The straits that beset me round about, straits. The narrow defiles through which I've walked, the muddy ground through which I've crawled, the great heartache, the soreness of sin, the weariness of the way. This is a land flowing even now with milk and honey unto me. This is a land where I see the angel of the Lord encamping round about those that fear him. This is a land that is a good land. Last night, I walked out the back door of where I live, and I looked around, and I looked at where I live, and I looked at the beauty of a starry night with a moon, and the bare trees, and the grass, and just what I can see. And to think that the Lord brought me to a place like this and gave me things I did not ask for, did not really desire, and I believe he gave them to me simply because he was my first desire. Remember, that's the pattern in the Bible. Solomon desired above all things wisdom. Wisdom would indeed indicate a knowledge of God, for Christ is the wisdom of God. And because he asked for wisdom, that he might do right in his office as king and rightly judge the people, God added to him all sorts of riches and things. They became a snare for his soul at some point, and he permitted himself to be snared. Yes, he did. He's accountable. So too are you and I. When God gives us blessings, and then we allow those blessings to become more important than God. If we do that, we're in a state of sin, and we should repent. Now, they say it is no place of seed, or of figs, or of vines, or of pomegranates. They're describing what they could get in Egypt. Neither is any water to drink. They live next to the big river, which regularly overflowed. But they forgot that God turned the river to blood. They forgot that God filled Egypt with lice. He filled Egypt with dead frogs. He brought upon the Egyptians a darkness that could be felt. I remember when I lived 24/7 in that darkness. The light that is in thee be darkness. How great is that darkness? It was horrible to live as a man not knowing Christ, left to my own devices, stumbling from folly to folly, sin to sin, woe to woe, sorrow to sorrow, and seeing no way out. It was only as the day star shined in my heart, it was only as God quickened me to see my utter hopelessness, it was only as God put his word in my ear so that I could see with my spiritual eye Jesus, made a little lower than the angels, crowned with glory and honor, that he by the grace of God should taste of death for every man. What is man that thou art mindful of him, or the son of man that thou visitest him? What am I but a potsherd of the earth, dust and ashes, but I'm also an heap of wheat in the Lord. They come and they chide with Moses and Aaron. And Moses and Aaron went from the presence of the assembly unto the door of the tabernacle of the congregation, and they fell upon their faces. They fell upon their faces, and they interceded. They prayed before the Lord. The people of God go down forward on their face. Those that are not of God go backward, stumble, and are taken, according to Isaiah. And you see that in the New Testament, too. You see it in the New Testament when they come to take the Lord Jesus Christ before the Sanhedrin, before the high priest. They fell upon their faces. Look what happens when you fall upon your face before God and you're one of God's people. And the glory of the Lord appeared out of them. When you fall upon your face in a time of conflict, remember what I just said. Miriam died. These two brothers, their sister died. The sister that made sure that Moses was returned to his mother. The whole of that account could be another story of the sovereignty of God, the power of God in the midst of the whirlwind of sin to have his way and keep his own in the earth. I believe that Moses, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Amos, Hosea, Habakkuk, Joshua over there, and Zechariah, and all the other men of God in the Old Testament are examples of the way God gloriously keeps alive upon the earth the souls of those he's chosen to redeem. Look at Abraham in the book of Genesis. 318 trained servants born in his household. He attacks five kings and beats them. What is that but the hand of God, not the hand of man? And I don't mean these little gods that men worship this day. No, not at all. I speak of the Creator of the ends of the earth, who neither faints nor is weary. There is no finding out about his understanding. He that sits upon the circle of the earth and counts the inhabitants thereof as grasshoppers, who meted out the heaven with a span. It's he that I have to do with. It's he that I have to deal with. The one that formed the light and created darkness. The one who makes peace and creates evil and says, I, the Lord, do all these things. That's the one with whom we have to do as Christians. And this has nothing to do with the fertility worship of the pagans. This has nothing to do with the death, burial, supposed death, burial, and resurrection of Krishna. It has nothing to do with Nimrod and Semiramis. The rest of them, no! Because the licentious, orgiastic, bacchanalia worship engaged in by enthusiast, an ecstatic, frenzied, hypnotized, fleshly-minded devotees of Romanism and all other pagan religions has nothing to do with the worship of God, Spirit, and Truth in the Bible. The two are miles apart because filthy, licentious acts, all sorts of cruelties and barbarities are perpetuated in the mystery religions. These are brought to a screeching halt by the God of the Hebrews in the King James Bible in the Old and the New Testament. My little children, keep yourselves from idols. And the Lord spake unto Moses, take the rod and gather thou the assembly together. Remember, this is an hour of temptation for Moses and for Aaron. And Aaron thy brother, and speak ye unto the rock before their eyes. And it shall give forth his water. The rock is called his. He gives forth his water that his children may drink. And thou shalt bring forth to them water out of the rock. Water flows out of the rock that was Christ. So thou shalt give the congregation their beast drink. Now 1 Corinthians 10, 1 through 4, but I'll only cite one part of it. For they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ. It doesn't mean the literal stone was Christ. The spiritual meat and the spiritual drink of God's people are the Lord Jesus Christ himself, as he manifests himself as the Word of God, quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. When he appears, all the tribes of the earth shall mourn. And when he comes to judge the world in righteousness and truth, a sharp two-edged sword goeth out of his mouth, that with it he shall smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron. See, Genesis 49:24b, Jacob said, "The mighty God of Jacob, from thence is the shepherd, the stone of Israel." A stone is a rock. Now, the rebellion and provocations of sinful men can cause even the very best of God's servants and saints to disobey the word of God. And then we'll see this. Moses did what he was told as far as taking the rod from before the Lord. I believe it was in the possession of Aaron. But he took it from before the Lord where it was laid up, as the Lord commanded him. And Moses and Aaron gathered the congregation together before the rock, and he said unto them, "Hear now, ye rebels, must we fetch you water out of this rock? Do we have to do this because you're in such unbelief?" He's angry. First, he's distraught. His emotions have been touched because his sister has died. Then the devil stirs up the people to fear that they will die of thirst after they've said they wish they were dead. And then Moses takes the rod from before the Lord and goes to perform and do what God said. But in the heat of his anger and subsequent to his grief, Moses took Aaron's rod that budded out of Aaron's hands from the place where it was before the Lord, as the Lord commanded him. So far, so good. He obeyed the Lord. But in the heat of anger, he disobeyed the Lord and smote the rock twice instead of speaking to it once. Moses lifted up his hand, and with his rod he smote the rock twice. And the water came out abundantly, and the congregation drank, and their beast also. Many years ago, back in 1991, I asked a minister in a series of what were basically sort of revival meetings. I raised my hand in a question and answer session. The general congregation, where only men were there, it was a men's meeting. And I said to him, "How come I've heard people that are obviously false prophets stand and say something that's the true word of God to me personally?" He said, "You remember something. Moses disobeyed God, but God met the needs of the people." There's a truth there. God met the needs of his people. Moses lifted up his hand, and with his rod he smote the rock twice, and the water came out abundantly. Look, God provided for his rebellious people, despite even the rebellion of his minister. God provides for his people through those whom he gives an unction to preach and minister unto, despite their own sin. Not that I say that you should sin, that grace may abound. God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? The Lord commanded his minister in the right, but chose to leave a possible wrong way open. The Lord commanded his servant to do it the right way, but the possibility of doing it the wrong way was left open. Despite the rebellion of all the human elements, God still loved and cared for his own. The Lord preserved souls alive that were utterly worthy of death, even as they in themselves believed him not, nor showed him to be holy. None of the people did right in this situation. None of them. If there were some, it must have been Joshua and Caleb, but we don't read of them. But the very act of rebellion that Moses committed in smiting the rock twice becomes a picture, a foreshadowing of the true rock and his suffering for our redemption. You see, the Lord is the rock. He is the rock, his work is perfect, for all his ways are judgment, and a God of truth, and without iniquity, just and right is he. Deuteronomy 3:32-4. Moses, as a preacher of righteousness, justifies God and not man. That's what every true preacher of righteousness does. He justifies God and finds fault with man, finds sin with man, and the only justification for man being Christ, imputing his righteousness to man by faith, who rose again. Christ rose again for our justification. Deuteronomy 32:15. But Jeshurun waxed fat and kicked. He forsook the God which made him and lightly esteemed the God of his salvation. Then Deuteronomy 32:31. For their rock is not as our rock, capital R, even our enemies themselves being judges. Christ was smitten twice by Moses with the rod. I'll show you two places where he was smitten. See, the very act of rebellion in Moses typifies and foreshadows the suffering of Christ, who died for many. Christ was smitten twice. Isaiah 50, verse 6, he was smitten of man. Read this, if you would, in your Bible. I gave my back to the smiters, and my cheeks to them that plucked off the hair. I hid not my face from shame and spitting. He's smitten of man. He gave his back to the smiters. His flesh was whipped raw. And he was smitten of God. Isaiah 53, 4. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God and afflicted. So Moses lifted up his hand and with his rod. Now notice, it's called Moses' rod, but the New Testament is called Aaron's rod. Take that principle and apply that to other parts of the scripture, and many things will open up to your mind. Something can be referred to yours, but it can also be your wife's. Something can be a familial possession, common to you all. These are just modes of speaking, methods of expression, which express a commonality of possession. But these things apply to many other historical incidents in both Testaments. Moses lifted up his rod, and with his rod he smote the rock twice. And the water came out abundantly, and the congregation drank, and their beast also. Awake, O sword, against my shepherd, and against the man that is my fellow, saith the Lord of hosts. Smite the shepherd, Zechariah 13:7, and the sheep shall be scattered. And I will turn mine hand upon the little ones, Zechariah 13:1. In that day there shall be a fountain opened to the house of David and the inhabitants of Jerusalem for sin and for uncleanness. When Christ was smitten of man and smitten of God, when he was numbered with the transgressors and died upon the cross and rose again the third day, he accomplished what was appointed for him, and yet what he willingly took up to do with his face set like a flint, saying, who is he that will contend with me? Let him draw near. No one could defeat the Lord Jesus Christ. He's my hero. He's my king. He's my judge. He's my lawgiver. No one can defeat him, though I be defeated constantly. I am not defeated in him. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. 1 Chronicles 21:17. This came to my mind. David is a type and a picture of Christ in the Old Testament. And he commits a sin. Now, Christ committed no sin, did no guile. No guile was in his mouth. He did no iniquity. But David is a type of Christ in being a prophet, a priest, and a king. After he's committed a transgression, he stands before the Lord and says, but as for these sheep, what have they done? Let thine hand, I pray thee, be on me and my father's house. You see what David prayed? Let God's hand be upon him and his father's house in judgment. Christ, after the flesh, came of the seed of David. David's prayer, David's desire in 1 Chronicles 21:17 is fulfilled in the Lord Jesus Christ. But as for these sheep, what have they done? Let thine hand, I pray thee. Now here David pleads the innocency of the people of Israel and his own guilt. This foreshadows the fact that an innocent one would come, and the guilt of the many would be placed upon him who must increase. He died for us who must decrease. Let thine hand, I pray thee, be on me and my father's house, but not on the people, that they should be plagued. All plagues of the heart are ultimately remedied by the work of Christ. As the psalm says, the reproaches of them that reproach thee have fallen on me. The reproaches of those that rebelled against the light, rebelled against the Father, were put upon him who was smitten of man and smitten of God. For he hath not despised nor abhorred the affliction of the afflicted, neither hath he hid his face from him. But when he cried unto him, he heard. Psalm 22:24. The efficacious, the efficient, the very, very, very uttermost accomplishing prayers ever prayed are prayed by the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. And he was heard. Speak unto the rock, that ye might be heard. Because when you speak unto the rock, and it's his work moving upon you to speak, you obey the Lord, and you'll find indeed that waters will flow forth from the rock, assuaging your grief, bearing your guilt, flooding your sin in a flood of God's blood. Acts 20:28. Speak to the rock. Well, till next time, this is Pastor Nelson Turner, and I encourage you to read your King James Bible and believe your King James Bible, to trust the Word of God, which is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, and is able to save on the uttermost all that come unto Jesus Christ by faith. May God richly bless you. Until next time, amen and amen.